Hey, what's going on, everyone? Welcome to another Reedsy Live, Reedsy's ongoing series of webinars where we bring on professionals from the world of publishing to show you how to write, publish, edit, market better books. Today is our very first webinar of the year, and I'm bringing with me Anna Bierhaus, who's a editor here at Reedsy, she would probably quickly correct, who's going to be talking all about pacing. It's a topic that a lot of people have been asking for us to cover, and hopefully we will deliver for you today. I see we've got quite a few people with us today. Anna's asked me not to mention how many people are on here. I'm sure she'll be fine, though, with the couple dozen of you who have turned up. But thank you so much for joining us. I hope some of you have seen some of our webinars from last year. You'll know what to expect. Anna's going to come on. We're going to have a quick chat. She'll give a presentation on her chosen topic, which in this case is pacing and writing, after which we're going to have a bit of a Q&A. So if you can stick around for a while, we'll hopefully get through as many of your questions as we can in that time. As always, we see a fantastic representation of people from all over. Hello from Philadelphia, Kegar. Jan Courtney from UK. Ian Worrell from Nova Scotia. And Stacey from Atlanta. Kathleen from Michigan. Keith from Michigan. Are you together, Keith and Kathy? Who knows? Paula Brown from Cambridgeshire here in the UK, who I believe, like London where I am, has been in lockdown for the last couple of days. So yeah, 2021 is a lot. It's quite 2020 so far. Elizabeth from Louisville, welcome, welcome. Basically, I'm just killing time while everyone shuffles in. It'll be a minute or so until Anna turns up. We're going to have a quick chat, and she's going to talk all about pacing in writing. I don't want to tease too much because we have got to fill some time with banter while people do roll in over the next 5 minutes. But don't you worry, we've got a great presentation lined up for you here. Diane's Perception from NYC. Werewolf Truth Howl from Oregon. Fantastic. I see Andrea from Nicosia, Cyprus. Welcome. Backings from Bury St. Edmunds, UK. Hi from Virginia, says Lillianne Milgram, too close to Washington, where democracy is facing a terrible... Oh, sorry. We've taken a very political turn already from this one. I've learned from the past to probably steer clear of that topic, but I'm glad you can all join today. Anna Velfman from Bonnie, Scotland, welcome. Cool. I hope you have all had a restful new year. I know a lot of folks usually put up a resolution of writing more or getting their first book done or some sort of publishing milestone as one of their resolutions. And hopefully we can give you a little bit of help and inspiration to get you started on yours today. But hey, it is 8 p.m. where I am, 3 p.m. on the East Coast, 12 p.m. on the West Coast. I think it's 4 a.m. in Singapore, 7 a.m. in Sydney. So why not let me bring on our guest for today. Please, everybody, welcome Anna Bierhaus. Anna, how are you doing?
Hi, everybody. I'm great. How are you?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Sorry, I'm just adjusting the volume. The last couple of webinars we've had here, I think the balance has been a little bit off, which is why I'm leaning into this microphone here. But I'm sure the folks in the comments will tell me if it's all a bit off. Anna, where are you today?
I'm in New York City.
Okay, so what's the current lockdown situation or shelter in place, or is it all pretty go there?
It's shut down, I mean, to some extent, like the outdoor dining. There's just outdoor dining. There's no longer indoor dining. Everybody's wearing masks and being careful, and I hope we'll be through this soon.
Yeah, it's just, you know, I think we just got it in our minds that it's just a few more months that we, you know, if we all stay a little bit disciplined and hunker down together, then we're going to make it through. But yeah, like I just said, we're going to wait a couple of minutes before we really start with the presentation. Everyone who's here, if you could do me a favor and just hit the like button, it'll mean a lot to me. And also, if you haven't subscribed to Reedsy already, make sure you do that. We've got plenty of new videos each week, and you'll get a notification every time we start a live video like this. Anna, before we start on our presentation for today, I was just wondering, have you read any good books of late?
I have. I read The Girls, Emma Klein. That was fantastic. And I've been reading a lot of psychological thrillers recently. And I'm really excited for Susan Choi's new book. She was one of my professors at NYU, and I loved her.
Oh, awesome. When's her new book coming out?
I think it's already out, to be honest. I think it came out this past fall.
Okay. But you're just saving it for the right time.
I'm saving it for the right time for 2021, right at the beginning. How are you? What are you been reading?
I've sort of been really behind in my reading. I'm currently in the middle of This Is How We Lose the Time War, I think. Oh. It's like quite a short book. It's written by two authors. I'm really bad at remembering these names, but it's sort of sci-fi and it's a bit of a love story and it's like, you know, a little bit abstract, but like, you know, deeply human. I'm really enjoying it right now. And it's like a super short read. Lizzie Conley says The Girls is the best. I'll post it up here just so I can actually put the comments in the right place for later. Thank you. Just wait. Uh-oh. My interface is in such a way that now that I've put her comment here, I can't even get rid of it. Anyway, we're about 3 minutes in. I see we've had a decent amount of people turn up and they're watching now. I'm going to let you get on with this. I think I'll be here in the background if you need anything. But otherwise I'll see you at the end for the Q&A.
Sounds good. All right. Well, hi, I'm Anna. I worked in publishing for a number of years. I worked at the literary agency Sanford J. Greenberger Associates. And then I was a writer recruiter for Marvel Comics, which means I would look for writers in different mediums, like a playwright or a screenwriter. And I would look for certain qualities and I would be like, oh, they'd be a great Punisher one-off writer. And I pair them with the editor, walk them through the process. I also worked at Oxford University Press and I taught intro to fiction and poetry at NYU. And now I edit for Reedsy, so please give me a shout. So today I'm gonna be talking about pacing and how to write a page turner in 4 steps. So the 4 steps that we're going to be exploring are conflict, stakes, solid scenes, and build to a climax. So first off, what is pacing? Pacing is how quickly a story moves. But if you think about it, a book is just static words on a page. So how do we create movement out of that? How do we create momentum? When I was a grad student at NYU, we had this professor assign the first 50 pages of The Hunger Games. And then the next day we were all gonna talk about it in class. And it was the only book the entire semester that everybody showed up to class completely exhausted because people couldn't stop at the 50 pages. They read the entire book in one night, in one sitting. So how can we do that? How can we achieve what Suzanne Collins did with The Hunger Games? So our first step is conflict. And in our lives, we don't like conflict. We want it really easy and like mellow, but with storytelling, conflict is essential because it drives the story forward. So how do we create conflict? A character wants something and they can't have it. And it's really important to set up conflict as early as possible, which means we need to know what the character wants early on as well. So in TV, an hour-long drama, they would usually set this up in the first 10 minutes. And that's actually kind of a generous number. It's earlier in the 10 minutes. And in a 30-minute comedy, they would do this in the first 5 minutes. And even in The Hunger Games, there's a first paragraph and there's 5 sentences in the first paragraph. And in the final sentence, she talks about how there's gonna be a reaping later. And just the way that the sentence is structured and with the word, the reaping, we know it sounds like very apocalyptic and we know that conflict is coming, that it's imminent. So in order to have a successful conflict, we have to be invested in the characters. And that doesn't mean we have to like all of them. Like if you think about Game of Thrones, there's probably like a few characters you liked, but you probably didn't like all of them. But we need to be able to root for some. And if you think about it too, it's kind of like watching a sporting event. So if there are two teams that are playing and you don't care about either, it's like very easy to just be like, and kind of be doing like the dishes or like whatever else while it's on. But if you're really invested in one of those teams, you're gonna be at the edge of your seat, you're gonna want quiet, like you're gonna be very, very focused on the game. So we want that same kind of investment in our characters, that same kind of focus. So how do we do that? How do we write characters that people are invested in? And it helps to build empathy for them. So I think the way to do this is to show us their vulnerable side. So if your character is a billionaire supermodel who graduated top of their class in Harvard, I at least would have a hard time relating to that. But if we learn that they had a hard childhood or they've been struggling with this one thing, then that helps let us in, and that showing us that vulnerable side, we can relate to that. And I think that's one reason why underdog stories are so timeless, is because there's a real vulnerability in being the underdog. The odds are stacked against you, and it's like the David and Goliath. And one other note on this, like one time a friend and I, we decided that for the next year, we were going to read with that question in mind. Like, how do you write a character that like people just naturally root for? And so we reconvened at the end of the year and we compared notes. And the one thing that we found between the two of us across the board was that the word grateful was often used with this character. So they would use it when they were talking about their life or in like a certain situation. And it doesn't mean that their life was perfect and like, you know, all these amazing things had happened. It's just that they were able to find the silver lining in situations. And there was something really compelling about that. So it could be worth asking yourself, what are characters that you felt most compelled by and rooted for the most? And were there certain words used to describe this character or words that the character used? So going back to conflict, it doesn't have to be a huge conflict. It doesn't have to be like aliens versus humans and like all of humanity is on the line. It could be two people exchanging a look in the kitchen. It could be on a small scale, and not one story is more valid than the other, but the conflict is essential. So in summary, conflict drives pacing, and the sooner you set it up, the better. In order to have successful conflict, we need to root for some characters in some way, or at least be able to empathize with them. And the conflict doesn't have to be a huge, massive conflict. It could be like stolen yogurt. So our second step is stakes. And stakes are, like, one way to think about stakes are, what will the character lose if they don't get what they want? And stakes are important because they show us what is on the line. And if nothing is on the line, then it doesn't matter and the story has less weight. And again, it doesn't have to be a matter of life or death. It could be if a couple gets caught in the affair, they'll be banished from their community, or the affair could lead to a strained relationship with one of their children. Or one other example is, it could be somebody really needs money. They're going to be evicted from their home. So they start stealing from work, but they also love their job and they don't want to lose it. So these are stakes, and they can be small or large, but it really helps with pacing if a story has them. So what are the stakes in your story? And this might seem like a little tangential, but like I'll circle back. But I don't know if you've ever been at like a cocktail party or a party, and there's a group of people talking in a circle, and someone tells a joke once and it's hysterical and everybody laughs. But then they tell the joke a second time and no one laughs, and it's like a little bit awkward. And it's because we know what to expect and the surprise is gone. But the same goes with stakes. If they stay the same throughout the story, then the story can start to feel stagnant. So what are ways that you can raise the stakes in your story? How can the situation go from bad to worse? And even better, like, what if your character, they get what they want, but getting what they want puts them in an even worse position than they were before? So two examples of things going from bad to worse are when Katniss, she's a tribute, this is in Hunger Games. So she's a tribute and she's with PETA and they're fighting for their lives. And at one point Katniss, there's kind of these rivals and they bomb the rivals' food supply. And something about the bomb, well, just like the noise of the bomb, the sound of the bomb, it creates this ringing in her ears and she loses her hearing for a little bit. And so like here she is, she's like being hunted by people and she needs all of her senses, and then she loses one of her senses. Like that's a really bad position to be in. Another example of this is in Hulu's Run. There's a daughter and she's being held captive, and like halfway through the story, she manages to escape. And so you're like, okay, she made it. But then she's recaptured by her captor And whenever she's brought back to where she's being kind of held against her will, like, it seems impossible. Like, the captor knows how she escaped the first time. And it's just like, it feels so hopeless. Like, there's no way she's ever going to be able to get out. And I don't want to give anything away, but just a way to like take something so that the stakes are always changing and it keeps getting worse and it keeps feeling even more and more impossible. All right. Sometimes a ticking clock can help escalate the tension and create stakes too. So an example of a ticking clock is if a detective has like 24 hours to catch a serial killer or another person will die, that kind of creates an added pressure and it can like really rocket the story forward. But those 24 hours, that's a ticking clock. But sometimes people think like, they'll think with a ticking clock that it only works for thrillers or horrors. But a ticking clock actually works for any kind of story. It doesn't have to just be a thriller. So like, for example, you could have a romance and one character has a month to make the other character fall in love with them. Or in Hillbilly Elegy, the main character goes home. His mom is sick, so he goes to the hospital to visit his mom. But back at Yale, he has a job interview for this like dream job that he's always wanted. And it's the next day. So there's kind of this question hanging over whenever he's visiting his mom, like, will he leave and go back for this interview or will he stay with his mom? And so these are examples of ticking clocks. So it might be worth asking yourself, like, is there a way to add a ticking clock into your story? Like, would that fit organically? So in summary, stakes don't have to be life or death. They should increase as the story goes on. And sometimes adding a ticking clock can help create a sense of urgency and the stakes become elevated that way. So our third step out of four is it's really vital to create solid scenes. So I had a professor say that storytelling was all about the release of information and what the reader learns when. So with scenes, it can be really helpful to know what's the most important information you're trying to get across and to use that as a guide. There's also that old adage that every scene should be doing two to three things. So every scene needs to move the story forward. And it sounds so simple and so obvious, but I think it's very easy to forget. And it's something I see a lot as an editor. And if you think about it, like if your goal is to kind of create like page turning and people turning to the next page very quickly, if you have this scene that doesn't really have a point. It's just bulk. It's just creating more page turning, but with like no real point. So the person's gonna slow down when they're reading it. And even like in the Hunger Games, there's no random 10 page scene about arts and crafts, just because the author liked a description of a painting or something like that. Everything moves the story forward. It's all there to serve the story. And I think it's hard sometimes as new writers or just as writers in general, because I think a lot of times people will write to find the story. So in order to doing that, they like by default are writing some scenes that may not serve the story because they're still kind of finding it. But then when they're going back and they're revising, there'll be like one really funny joke that they love in the scene, or there'll be like one description that they really love. And so they won't get rid of the scene because they love this thing and it's like very hard to cut, even though the scene doesn't move the story forward. So one thing that I found that really helps with this, because it hurts to cut that, you know, like if you, especially if you love like one part of it. But the one thing that I found that really helps with this, and it really has helped my clients a lot, is to create a maybe doc. And that's just a new document. And you take the scenes that don't particularly work in the story and you put it in the maybe doc. And maybe you'll use it again. I mean, you could even label like funny joke or like description here. And then in your next book, you can, maybe you need that. Maybe you need a funny joke about arts and crafts. And so you go back and you look and you can find it and then you can kind of tweak it and use it again. And so it's not like you're cutting it completely. You still have it and you're still serving story. That's still your most important priority. But you're even getting like a little bit, you're getting like a little bit of a benefit for your second story too. And also like, I do think as we're saying, if you're a funny writer or you're very good at descriptions, like you're going to do it again. You know, if you wrote a funny joke in one scene, if you write the scene again and it serves the story, like you're probably going to have an equally funny joke in that scene because you're just like a funny person or you're good at descriptions. All right. So Chekhov's gun. So Chekhov said if a rifle is on stage in the first act, then it must go off in the second or third act. So in other words, seed or foreshadow what will come. So even if we go back to the Hunger Games in that opening paragraph, in that last sentence, the reaping, we have a foreshadow of what's going to happen, which is the reaping. And we know that that's going to come soon in the story. And so it kind of creates foreshadowing, and it creates this anticipation, and we're not quite sure what the reaping is. So we're kind of reading to figure what it is out. Even if you think of like the Blair Witch Project, not like you never see the witch in it. It's a story all about anticipation and all about dread. So like you have people camping and like they'll wake up and there's like twig figures outside their tents, or they'll hear weird sounds at night, but you never really see that witch. The whole story hinges on anticipation and dread. So these are like powerful story tools that can really keep people invested in the story. But to go back to the rifle, to Chekhov's gun, it's really important to pay it off. So if you do have a paragraph describing a gun or whatever it is, and then it never comes up again, it creates this disappointment in the reader. The reader is kind of, for lack of a better way to put it, kind of like, why did you waste my time with this description if it doesn't really serve the story? Kind of the one exception to this, I think, would be red herrings. So like in a detective story, sometimes you'll use a red herring so it's not too obvious like who the killer is. And I think that that works fine. But I think just generally, like, you know, if you set something up, like it's really important to have it pay out. So the last point on scenes, enter a scene late and leave early. So a lot of writers that I work with, or just like in general, I think a lot of new writers will write a story with a person getting out of bed. And again, there's nothing wrong with this. Like in the Hunger Games, that's exactly how the novel started. So that's like a great way to start. But I think sometimes what can happen is then we start off with the character getting out of bed. But then they kind of make breakfast and then they drive to work. And then like on page 30, the story starts. But I think it's really important to kind of dive in where the action starts. So really thinking about like what information you're trying to get across in that scene and starting then. And then we don't need that padding in the beginning, and we don't really need that padding in the end either. Like trim what serves the scene and getting that information out. And what I mean by like leave the scene early. So sometimes like if a character is leaving a party, it's kind of weird. Like you don't want them to seem like a jerk if they're leaving and they're not saying goodbye to people. But then it's also tricky because like if they say goodbye to every person at the party, it's kind of like creating this narrative drag. So like, what do you do? So sometimes like with art, we know that it's not really going to mimic real life, like, you know, just be a complete mirror. And so we'll kind of get it. Like if they say goodbye to one person, that could be a stand-in, or maybe we just even cut out before they leave the party and we'll just kind of infer that eventually they do leave the party. All right, so in short, every scene must move the story forward, create foreshadowing, and that can add dimension to scenes and really create a sense of anticipation, which really helps with narrative drive. And it helps to leave a scene, enter a scene late and leave early. So our last step, our fourth one, is to build to a climax. And this goes for all kinds of stories. It's not just thrillers. It can be comedies, romances, like whatever type of story. And we really want that feeling of escalation to the climax. So I said this before, and then I'm going to kind of add on to it, but it helps if the stakes are raised over the course of the story, so you do get that sense of escalation. But it can help too if you do this for both external and internal problems. So in Lord of the Rings, as Frodo gets deeper into Mordor, there's more external problems because he's in enemy territory. So there's like orcs and like all these like real dangers around him, and they're close. But also the internal issues are growing too, because he has the ring and it's kind of taking it more and more of a toll on his psyche. So you get that real sense of escalation kind of on both fronts. And I also want to say here, if you're having a problem with the climax and it's not working, a lot of times people will just stay focused on the climax and they're like, how can I get this to work? How can I get this to work? But usually if you are having that problem with the climax, it's an earlier structural problem. I know. I don't know if you guys can hear the sirens.
It sounds like it's right there in the room with you.
Sorry. It'll pass. It'll pass. Let's see. So the same thing is true with second act problems. So people will kind of think with the climax, like it's just the climax, but it's really kind of an earlier structural problem. But the same is true with the second act. So if people are like, you know, I'm having a problem with the second act, like it's just not working, that problem is usually a root in the first act and things haven't been properly seated or set up. So that's like a good thing to keep in mind if you're ever finding yourself struggling in one act to kind of look a little bit earlier in the story. All right, so it can help with building to your climax if your characters have some kind of flaw and that's really tested in the climax. So like, will Frodo be able to destroy the ring in Lord of the Rings, or will that same greed for the ring grip him as it did with Gollum? Or in The Queen's Gambit, will Beth be able to overcome her addictions and beat the Russian? And in both of these examples, these are things that the characters have been struggling with throughout the story. It's not like a new set of issues thrown in for the climax, and the stakes are raised. So I already talked about Lord of the Rings, but in The Queen's Gambit, Beth has a chance to be the grandmaster, which is the highest skill level in chess. And she loves chess and she's always wanted this. This is like a dream of hers. But she's also facing the height of her addictions because she suffered a loss, which I won't go into because I don't want to do a spoiler. But the loss triggers her addictions to kind of like pull at her and like entice her the most in her life as well. So we have these two parallel moments where it's like, her addictions are tugging on her at the hardest they've ever tugged on her. And then she has this like the thing that she's always wanted, to play with the Russian and to become a grandmaster. They're kind of happening simultaneously. So like, how can you get these two things to kind of crescendo at the same time? So it helps to ask yourself, what is a character struggle and how can that reach a fever pitch in the climax? So I also had a professor. I've had some great professors who would talk about how Homer in Greek tragedies would use very, very beautiful lyrical language right before violence. So it would lull the reader into the sense of peace and then bam, something awful would happen. And it's kind of like the calm before the storm. So this contrast can really help heighten the fall and that high to low, it really paints it in like a stark contrast. And you also get that moment of hope where you're like, the character is going to make it after all. And then the hammer drops and like you feel it even more because you just had that high. So this is another, it's like a slight tangent of an anecdote, but like I'm going to bring it back to climaxes. So I love surfing and I do it very, very badly. And I remember when I was first starting out, I never realized I could control my own speed. And when I did, it like blew my mind. So to control speed in surfing, you put more weight on the front foot. And then to slow down, you put more weight on your back foot. So like it blew my mind. And I think that writers can kind of feel the same way about that because you can control the speed, you can control the pacing of the writing and you can make things move faster. And one way to do that, one way to kind of speed things up is to play with sentence length, scene length, and chapter length. And when all of these things are shortened, it increases speed. So that's why a lot of times thriller writers, they'll use the short sentences and the short scenes and the short chapters. And like literary writers will kind of use the long flowing sentences to talk about like a psychological insight or explore that. But it's also like another way to kind of think about it is like in a film, in a fight scene or like, you know, some kind of like car chase or something like that, there are all these like cuts, like the camera's making all these like cuts and like the angles are changing and it's all very fast. You kind of get this like sense of momentum and it feels very dynamic. And you can do the same thing by working with the sentence length and the chapter length and the scene length. And it really does kind of create this movement forward. So in short, it helps to raise both the internal and external conflict, not just one or the other. And it helps if a character's flaw is tested in the climax. And you can control the speed. So if you want to move faster, use shorter sentences, scenes, and chapters. And if you want to slow down and create that calm before the storm, aim for longer sentences, scenes, and chapters. And I have a quick little bonus. Dialogue can also create speed in scenes because dialogue tends to be shorter. So, and it has more white space on a page. It just, so you're not reading through these like paragraph, like bulky, you know, lots of text on the page. It's just these short kind of lots of space on the page. So two ways to improve dialogue. The first one is to read. And the second is I really encourage people, if they're watching Netflix or Hulu or whatever it is, to try watching it with closed captioning, it's like whenever you get the dialogue, so people say things out loud and then you get the text at the bottom. And I really think doing that over time, it helps you kind of internalize the dialogue that you're seeing on TV and how naturalistic it is. And then people are always kind of surprised by how short it is. It's usually not like these like long soliloquies and stuff like that. It's like this short, punchy dialogue. And I really do find that it improves writers' dialogue over time if they do this. So that is it for me. I really hope it's been helpful. And I wish everyone a happy 2021. So thank you. I appreciate your time.
Sorry there, my microphone wasn't on well. We're not going anywhere just yet. Anna has kindly agreed to stay on and answer some of your questions. It takes a little while for our broadcast to go out to them and for people to send questions back in. So I'll clear up a bit of housekeeping in the meantime. Anna, yes, is available to work with you on your next book. By the time you hear this, about 20 seconds ago, I posted a link in the comments to her Reedsy profile. If you're interested, go and check out her portfolio, send her a request. Anna, are there any sort of books or projects you're sort of looking for at the moment?
I'm open. I love commercial fiction, but I also read a lot of literary fiction as well.
Okay, so. Cool. That pretty much covers the full gamut.
Yes, it does.
Cool. Yeah, I really enjoyed a lot of the very specific points in there. It reminds me of so much of my own bad writing from the past, as well as some of the other books I read. The idea of really shortening your sentences and chapters. I remember a massive revelation was reading Dan Brown for the first time, where it's I couldn't believe these chapters are literally a side and a half long each, and they just properly rattle through them. And you're not wrong. You really can't stop turning the pages when so much stuff is happening at such a quick pace, regardless of what you think about these authors.
Yeah, and you can manipulate it too. So if you do want a scene to move faster, you can do that. But then if you're at the point in the story where you want things to be that calm before the storm, then you can kind of lengthen things and make it, a little bit more peaceful.
Ooh, we've got a question here from Marlin Ort. Actually, let me change to this view. How can multiple characters POV be used for pacing? I imagine that affects it quite significantly.
Yeah, it can. So I think one way to do that is you can, if you want to use the shorter chapters and the shorter scenes, you can kind of jump back and forth between them. And I think that can help. But I think ultimately, I think it can go either way. I mean, I don't think I think you can definitely use it to your advantage. But I think sometimes if you can just avoid head hopping, I think would be the main point there, which I don't know if people are familiar with head hopping, but that's sometimes in an action scene, I've seen this a lot where we're in one character's point of view for most of the novel, but then in the action scene, we start head hopping to other different characters in the action scene. So we're not just with our protagonist, and that can actually slow down the pacing because we're getting all these different point of views and it's much harder to track. So I think just any time that aim for clarity, and I think clarity can really drive that forward. I don't know. I hope that answers that question.
That's great. We've got a question here from Antoine, what are your thoughts about integrating flashback when you are trying to move the action forward?
I think, you know, it depends. Like, I think it's like how it's executed. Usually people say with flashbacks and dreams, they're tricky because there's nothing narratively at stake. So it's not happening in present scene. It's not happening like in present action. So we already know usually the outcome of a flashback, or in a dream, there's nothing like nobody's in danger in a dream, or there's nothing on the line in the dream because it's just, you know, somebody sleeping. So I think it just depends on the execution. Like, I'm sure there are instances where this would be, it could really move the action forward. But there is also this general rule that sometimes flashbacks can kind of create this narrative drag because nothing is on the line.
Cool. There's some questions about what we're going to do with this presentation afterwards. What we're going to do is, this entire video stream is going to be available right at this link from now until the heat death of the universe. Also, if you signed up on Eventbrite, I'll send out a follow-up email in a couple of days with a transcript to this. So if you're worried about missing something or you don't really want to sit through another 40 minutes of everything, you'll be able to read through that, get all the bits you need. So don't worry about that. If you're not signed up, just go to blog.readsy.com/live. And then you'll be able to find it there in just a few days. Let's see. I've got quite a few questions, but they're sort of along the same thing. A Robin Story asks, how can you tell when a scene's pacing is too slow?
So I think it can help to have beta readers or even an editor on Reedsy, because I think a lot of times if you're the writer of something, something in your mind is so clear and it seems so obvious to you, but maybe something on the page isn't translating. And if somebody reads this, they're like, oh, I thought, you know, the person had already left the room, when in fact, in your story, the person's still in the room, and then it creates this huge confusion. And so then the scene doesn't really make sense for the reader. But just like a beta reader or an editor could catch that very quickly. And then you can make these small tweaks, and then all of a sudden the scene is like, you know, super fast and like has a ton of momentum. So I think kind of sometimes just asking somebody can really help tell, because I think as a writer, we do have these blind spots, and it's like everybody has it. There's just no way around it, you know? But that's a good question. These are all great questions.
Here's an interesting one. How can you improve pacing when you're dealing with a plot that I guess is based on true events? Like, you know, if you're writing a memoir or something that, you know, you are expected to stick to the truth in a sense.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it's kind of going back to about the scenes, like enter late and leave early. I think it's just really kind of thinking about the story and thinking about what's the most compelling about the story and centering in on conflict. And then it's not like you're changing anything. It's just you're really staying true to the most compelling parts of the story and what you find most interesting, and staying true to that and using that as kind of like a North Star as you're writing it and then as you're editing it. I think that can really help.
We've got a very specific question from Jessica Coronado. Should you avoid cutting back and forth from moment to moment the way they do in movies, playing two scenes on a single page? I guess it's sort of like cross-cutting where you're almost relaying two scenes at the same time, cutting between the two.
I think that could get tricky. Like, I could see as you're reading it how it could maybe be confusing. Again, it's all in execution, so maybe this would be like brilliantly done, and like I'm sure that it is. I don't know because it's not in front of me, but I can see how that would be hard to pull off, or like potentially very tricky. I think more what I was trying to get at with the movies is just kind of these short sentences and these short scenes can really create a sense of momentum. I think sometimes writers think that they have a chapter length and like every chapter has to be 10 pages for like the rest of the book, that has to happen. And I'm just kind of trying to play with the idea of like, you know, maybe you can be creative with your scenes and create the sense of movement and have a purpose. Like this chapter is going to be a little bit longer because I'm trying to do this in this chapter. And this chapter is going to be a little bit shorter because I'm trying to like really speed up the pacing here right at the climax.
We've got not so much a question as a request. Pages ask you to play the hits. Please say more about foreshadowing. If you have nothing to say, I've got sort of a related question, I guess.
I wish I knew. I'm trying to think of what more to say on foreshadowing. Like, what particular, can we do a follow-up question? Like, is there a particular aspect of foreshadowing?
Yeah. So I guess, like, one of the things you mentioned is the idea of, like, Chekhov's gun. What, you know, as readers, we're all kind of conditioned to sort of understand, this is of relevance. But, you know, I guess, is there, like, a fine, do you know of any sort of examples, I guess, of books where, you know, they have seeded this thing and you sort of have remembered it later on when it pays off, but you haven't necessarily twigged, oh yes, this is the thing, this is the jumper that will be significant later? Or
that's a good question, and I'm sure there's so many books that do this, but off the top of my head, I'm trying to think of, like, something that seeds, like, a story that seeds something very well.
Paige is actually, I got back. I think she was specifically how it helps with pacing.
Foreshadowing helps with pacing because it can create this sense of anticipation, this sense of dread that something's happening, that something is going to happen. So, like, for example, let's say in your story, you really need to show a happy couple because later something is going to, like, something awful is going to happen. Like, one of them is, like, a hitman or something, and, like, something bad is going to happen. But if you show them for 20 pages and, like, everything is, like, amazing and they love each other and, like, they're constantly saying how much they love each other and just everything is awesome, it's going to be hard to wade through all that because it's going to feel like, one, it's hitting the same beat over and over again. And also there's no conflict and there's no narrative tension. But if you were to write that same happy couple, and then there's moments of, like, foreshadowing of what's going to come, like, maybe one of the couple is, like, acting kind of sketchy, or maybe one night the windows are broken and they're not sure why the windows are broken, and they come up with a perfectly logical reason. So they think that it's problem solved. But as the reader, you're kind of, there's, like, a flag there, and you kind of know something is going to happen later. Like, if you get enough of these kind of unusual circumstances, it keeps the reader reading and, like, wondering what's going to happen. So I think that's how foreshadowing can help with pacing, is you can still have these moments and you can still build this relationship of this couple and show how amazing they are, and create that contrast later for what will come. I don't know if that example.
No, that's great. That's great. We've got a slight change of pace. Andrea asks, how did you know that book editing was the path for you? And as a bonus question, what would you say is your favorite book?
For book editing, I just loved books. I was always a kid that was reading. I loved going to the library. I still love going to the library. I loved books. It was a passion of mine. And I love storytelling, just stories in general. As for a favorite book, I don't know if I have a favorite book. And if I did, it probably would change every year. Like, I do find myself, I probably read The Great Gatsby more than any other book. But I still don't know if I would say that's my favorite, but I will say I love that book. There's so many great voices out there.
Okay, here's one from Elena. How specific should the writer be in describing the main character? What are the most important details?
I think it depends on what type of story you're telling. So, like, if you're telling a romance, for example, I think, they tend to have more character descriptions, both psychologically, and then also, like, you usually get kind of a physical description as well. Whereas some stories you get that less, maybe even a detective story, you get that too a lot, just to kind of, like, you, all the different characters you meet along the way in a detective story, like, their appearances are so important because they can kind of lead their little clues in those appearances. But as for the main character, I think, I wouldn't say, like, 10 pages straight of description is really necessary, but I think, to me, the best writing is the most visual writing. So it's something, I'm reading this book and I can imagine exactly what's happening in my mind, almost as if it were a movie or a show, or just, like, you, it's just very, very visual. So I think if you can be visual in a very succinct way, I think that that's, to me, I love that. I'm immediately pulled in.
Cool. Yeah, I imagine that'll be a bit more of a challenge if you're writing in first person. I suppose, like, people very rarely, like, I look into the mirror, I see a 50-year-old man.
It is. Although you do get it sometimes. You do get it sometimes. Like, actually in 50 Shades of Grey, in the first page, she physically describes herself, and it's first person, I believe. Okay. So like, especially, I do think in women's fiction, you get it more, but I think in sci-fi, for example, like you wouldn't have a first person character really look in the mirror as much as I think you would in some other genres.
We've got a great question here from Caroline Tell. Do you have any advice on writing bridge scenes that link two bigger scenes that need more connective tissue without dragging the pacing?
Again, it's kind of hard to talk about it. For me, like it really helps if I can see the scenes. It's kind of hard to talk about it just like generically of ways to help that. But let me see if I can think very quickly. I mean, I think, again, it's like going back to like what information are you trying to get across? Like in scene A that you're trying to link to scene B, what is it that you're trying to link? And how can you link that? Is there like a conflict you can tie to it? Is there a ticking clock that you can tie to it? Is there just some way that you can make that scene like just a little bit more compelling or amp up the tension in some way? But it could be interesting too to write it and not have a bridge scene and see how that reads and have somebody look over it. And maybe they're like, I don't even think you need the bridge scene. So there's a number of different ways you can go with it.
Yeah. But I guess, do appreciate it. Yeah. Like the way you enter the second scene can pretty much, you know, you can probably cover a lot of stuff that you would have in the bridge scene. Like, you know, if you need to show that it's been raining because that's going to come into later, you just, you know, show your character dusting, you know, drying off their umbrella in the first action beat. And then go into it. Like, as you say, like, if it doesn't actually serve to move it forward, like, you probably can fit those plot details in elsewhere.
Yeah. And, so, like, you can even maybe use more subtext in the second scene, and that kind of links in what happened in the bridge. So that's a way to kind of potentially address that as well.
Cool. I'm going to try and look for just one more in there. Sorry, there's a lot of great questions coming in. It's hard for me to find sort of goes on. Someone's asked, how do you know if your pacing is too fast? But I don't know, is that like an issue? Do people like, you know, are like, are they overwhelmed when it's too fast for too long?
I mean, I think usually that's not so much a problem unless like sometimes people will do that at the sake of like descriptors sometimes. So it's just like straight action and like we don't get any of the characters, like we don't know how they're feeling. We don't know what they're thinking. It's just straight action. And I think sometimes that could maybe be like you're sacrificing character development in some ways. So like maybe that would be a time when it's too fast.
Cool. Sorry, I'm still trying to find one more. I had to do a little bit of business in the comments there. Yeah, while I'm looking for this, is there any book in particular you're looking forward to in 2021?
Oh man, I'm looking forward to many of them. Especially, I mean, I know the Susan Choi, I think it came out last year, but I'm really looking forward to, she was a great professor and a great writer, so.
Ooh, okay. I'm trying to find ones. A lot of them are like very specific to each individual one. Oh, okay. CO Savvy has a, is there a rule for cliffhangers? How soon into the next chapter should the cliffhanger in the previous chapter be resolved?
I think it's just a matter of what the story dictates. Like, I don't think there's any hard or fast rule. Like, I think it's just like what's most organic. And like, I trust your judgment on that. Like if you're thinking, oh, I need to resolve this right away so I can set these other things up. Like, I trust your judgment in that. Or if you're like, I want to hang this out, you know, I want to like kind of hang it on the hook and come back to it and circle back to it at the end of the chapter and then maybe create another cliffhanger out of it. Like, I trust your judgment on that too. I think it's just like, yeah, there's no hard and fast rule on that.
Sorry. Yeah, like a lot of thrillers, I guess, will, you know, end each scene with a massive cliffhanger. And then, you know, it's not like on television where you have to wait a whole week to find out what happens. It very much is a case of like in the first few lines, or maybe it'll skip a chapter where the action's happening. But yeah, I find like books that do that too often where every single chapter ends in some sort of revelation that turns out to be not quite as significant as it seems, sort of lessens the impact as they go on.
And I think sometimes too with cliffhangers, like if it feels like the author is like intentionally withholding information, like if it feels like they're just kind of drawing out the scene so that the information gets, we'll kind of keep reading for the answer of this cliffhanger, but it feels drawn out. I think sometimes that can like work against the cliffhanger. So you've almost done like this incredible job of setting up a cliffhanger, but then you've almost dampened it because you've waited so long to kind of reveal what happens. So I do think that's like kind of like a tight line, tight rope or tight line that you're kind of walking along. But I think, you know, again, like some of these things, you kind of have to see what happens and you kind of play around with it and then it will fall into place. So it just might take a little tweaking.
Gerben says, Reedsy, you need to find an assistant for finding good questions and responding to the chat messages. I think a lot of us are based here in Europe, so I'm the only one willing to stay up that late. We have another sort of inside baseball question from HL Noss. What would be your advice to another editor on spotting pacing and sort of, I guess, delivering feedback on pacing?
An editor delivering feedback on pacing. Again, I think it's like, I think it's kind of in the execution. Like, I think it depends on what the story is that you're particularly reading and like what genre it is and what type of story it is. And then also like maybe if the writer, they have like certain questions or certain strengths that you're trying to like feed into or certain weaknesses that you're trying to like build up. So I think it's kind of hard without like a specific, you know, piece in front of me to be able to say, but I think reading would probably be one thing, one great piece of advice is just having examples of just seeing like, look at how this writer did it and how did this writer do it? And then kind of using the example so they can kind of see, oh, this person did this so well. And like, I'm not doing this here. And if I did this here, that would kind of solve this, issue. Cause I do think a lot of writing is problem solving. Like there's like this old Mitch Hedberg joke where if you have a broken escalator, it's not broken because then it turns into stairs. And I've always really liked that. And I think that it's kind of the same with writing is it's just like, it's a big puzzle and it's a big game and you're kind of trying to figure out like you have one problem and then you solve that. And then like a little ripple problem kind of comes from that. And then you solve that, but it is, it's just like problem solving, I think is what it comes down to.
Cool. One final question. So one you might not have an answer to in particular. Elizabeth McIver, any craft books on writing that you would recommend?
I really like Annie Lamott's Bird by Bird and Stephen King on writing. Trying to think of other ones. That's a very, very...
Those are both super solid. Yeah, I've read those. Like Lamott's book like reads really nicely. And Stephen King's one is like a bit of a memoir as well.
Those are two.
Cool. All right. Well, I think that brings us up to 8:50 where I am. Thank you so much, Anna. That was really great. As we mentioned, we're going to do a transcript of this. If you are signed up on Eventbrite, I'll send a follow-up email with a link to that and also a link to our next Reedsy Live. It's happening in 2 weeks. Editor Rebecca Heyman. She'll be hosting another one of her First Line Frenzies where you will have the opportunity to send in the first line of any book or story you're working on. We'll pick 20, 30 of them at random and she'll critique them live right here on YouTube. So it's a good opportunity to share your writing, get some feedback on it. And it's a lot of fun. And that's it. Anna, I want to thank you so much. It's been such a great one. Thank you for doing our very first one of 2021. Our first webinar of the future, as I like to call it.
It's been a pleasure. And thank you. And thanks everybody for their time and their wonderful questions.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I'll put down Anna's link to her Reedsy profile just one more time. Otherwise, you know how to find her. Anna Bierhaus, Reedsy, just Google that one. Happy New Year, everyone. Hope you have a safe an enjoyable one. I'll see you very soon. Goodbye, everyone.